Hello everyone. Today in this video we are going to start with next type of passive devices. These are called as ferrite devices. Now ferrite devices are type of iron metals, as it is mentioned in the first statement. Now these ferrite devices, when they are affected by a DC magnetic field, they exhibit the Faraday rotation. Now this, what is Faraday rotation, that we are going to see. But whenever we apply a magnetic field, or DC magnetic field to be precise, a metal which is a ferrite type of metal exhibits a Faraday rotation. So the ferrite devices like circulators or isolators, these exhibit the same Faraday rotation, and this can be used for achieving desired results in the microwave circuits. Okay, so the both microwave circulators and isolators are non-reciprocal transmission devices that use the property of Faraday rotation in ferrite material. So this property of Faraday rotation, which we are going to see just now, is used to design these devices like circulators and isolators. So in order to understand the principle of circulator, we must understand first the behavior of ferrite in the non-reciprocal phase shifter. So what is non-reciprocal phase shifter? Just in the last videos we have seen what is a phase shifter. These are simply devices that produces a desired phase shift in the incoming signal. So what is non-reciprocal? Non-reciprocal means it produces a phase shift in a different amount in opposite directions. That means if a phase shifter is producing 90 degree going in the forward direction, then it will provide, let's say, 30 degree in the backward direction. So the amount of phase shift produced is not equal, and that's why it is reflected in the S matrix of that device, and this S matrix is non-reciprocal. That's why these are called as non-reciprocal phase shifters. Okay, so these non-reciprocal phase shifters consist of a thin dielectric slab, which used to be a dielectric in previous cases. Now it will be consisting of a ferrite material. When this ferrite slab is placed in a rectangular waveguide at a point, so where we have to place this slab at a point where DC magnetic field of an incident wave is circularly polarized. That means if we have a rectangular waveguide, we have to place a ferrite slab. Just like we have seen in the last videos, attenuators use a dielectric slab at the center for producing the desired attenuation. Now similarly, we are going to provide a ferrite slab somewhere here. Now somewhere means where? At a point where DC magnetic field will be circularly polarized. Now why it will be circularly polarized, that we will see in the Faraday rotation. Because circularly polarized means it will be like clockwise direction, this is the direction of magnetic field, or it may be anti-clockwise, like magnetic field will intensity will be like this one. So this is circularly polarized. So why it gets circularly polarized? That is because of Faraday rotation. So let's look at what is Faraday rotation. Now these ferrites exhibit Faraday rotation, just as I said, because ferrite is a non-linear material. So its response is a non-linear, and its permeability is a asymmetric tensor. Now these are new terms. If you don't know what is a tensor, it is a term used in mathematics. Tensor is a type of a object which is used to map different objects into a simple one. For example, to understand it in our context, let's not get in detail about mathematical concept. To understand, we are calling these ferrite materials exhibiting Faraday rotation because of ferrite having a non-linear material and its permeability. We are talking about permeability of the ferrite materials. Now permeability, as we know, is the amount of increase or decrease in a particular property like magnetic property or electric property. So most of the times it is in terms of magnetic property. So permeability is denoted by vector mu. Now what is the value of this vector mu? It is called as an asymmetric tensor. Why we are calling it as an asymmetric tensor? Because mu vector is a combination of different objects. Now, where mu 0 is a permeability in the free space, it is a vector, into there is a multiplication of a scalar term and a matrix, which is denoted by chi vector. This is a chi vector, chi m vector. So our permeability vector is mapping a scalar, a vector, addition and multiplication into a single term. So four different objects are mapped into a single object, that is mu vector, and that's why it is called as a tensor. So tensor is a combination or mapping of different objects into a single entity. That is in our context. To know more about tensor, you can refer the mathematics or algebra. So this mu is a given by this particular formula, where chi m is a matrix. It is called as a tensor magnetic susceptibility. Now the susceptibility means ability. In our case, it is a magnetic susceptibility. So whenever we apply a magnetic field, then what is the response of that particular device? That is nothing but magnetic susceptibility. How does it respond is given by susceptibility. It is sometimes called as a, or in general terms, it can be called as a sensitivity or maybe vulnerability also. So that is generalized term. To be precise, in our physics or microwave concepts, magnetic susceptibility, when we apply a magnetic field to a device, how does that device respond? That is measured by the susceptibility. So this chi m vector is a magnetic susceptibility, but it is tensor magnetic susceptibility. Now this is also a tensor, although it is a matrix, in a matrix form. This is not in a matrix form entirely. This is in matrix form of, you can see, real values and a imaginary value also, where chi m is a diagonal susceptibility and k is a off diagonal susceptibility. Okay, so it is also a tensor, and that's why this is also a tensor. Now because of this tensor, that means it is a complex type of object, the material that is made up of ferrite is non-linear. It is non-linear because of this complex property. Okay, so because of this, the polarization produced is angular, that is considered as a Faraday rotation. This was devised or invented by Faraday, that's why name is a Faraday rotation. Now how this polarization is affected because of Faraday rotation, let's see that. When a DC magnetic field is applied to ferrite, so this is our ferrite material, let's say we are applying a DC magnetic field, the unpaired electrons, that means electrons which have not formed a bond, formed a bond with the holes, these are called as unpaired electrons. So these unpaired electrons in the ferrite material tend to line up with the DC field. So wherever DC field is there, these unpaired electrons will come towards this DC field because of their magnetic dipole moment. Okay, because these unpaired electrons have a magnetic dipole moment, and that's why they will be lining up with the DC field. However, because of non-reciprocal precession of unpaired electrons, it causes their relative permeabilities mu r plus and mu r minus. Relative permeability means permeability with respect to holes and with respect to electrons to be unequal, because these are unpaired electrons. So number of holes and number of electrons present in the material will be unequal, and the wave in the ferrite, that's why it becomes a circularly polarized. So if they are equal, that means holes and electron, if they are equal, then all of them will get paired most of the time. Some of them may remain unpaired, but that will be not a problem because it will not cause a substantial amount of rotation. But if these unpaired electrons come together towards the DC field, then the wave in the ferrite will be circularly polarized. Okay, and the propagation constant for linearly polarized wave, now if the wave is a linearly polarized, either in horizontal or in the vertical direction, whatever it is. So this is horizontal and this is vertical. If a wave is a linearly polarized, then the propagation constant going in forward direction and in the backward direction inside the ferrite can be expressed as propagation constant with superscript given as plus or minus is given by this particular formula. Again, you can see it is a function of permeability in a free space, overall permeability and off diagonal susceptibility along with the permittivity of the material. So these formulas are, this is the just a background to understand why the waves are circularly polarized. That means when a wave is incident, why they move in the particular direction. In our case, circularly means in a circular direction, and that can be used for achieving devices such as circulator and isolator. So let's not get into detail about why this propagation constant is this one. Now the relative permeability changes with applied DC magnetic field. So this permeability changes with the DC magnetic field because it is given by, again, mu r plus is given by this formula. So don't worry about the formula, you don't need to remember this. From this formula, what we can observe that if we have to calculate mu r plus, okay, the denominator term, which is consisting of propagation constant multiplied by DC magnetic field minus, so in terms of mu r plus, here it should be minus. So if omega is equal to propagation constant into DC magnetic field, like HDC, let me write it again, HDC, then if it is negative, then this will become zero, this denominator will become zero for mu r plus, and if this is zero, mu r plus will become infinity. Okay, so the terms used here, you can refer, propagation constant is a gyromagnetic ratio of an electron, so gamma e. So if we have to calculate mu r plus, if we keep omega is equal to minus of gamma e into HDC, then mu r plus will be infinite. Okay, so how does that affect? It can be seen from that equation that if omega is equal to, as I said, this one, mu r plus is infinite. This phenomena is called as gyromagnetic resonance of the ferrite. And if mu r plus is much larger than mu r minus, the wave in the ferrite is rotated in the clockwise direction. So in short, if we have to summarize this, if positive relative permeability is much larger than the negative relative permeability, then ferrite is rotated in clockwise direction. So positive permeability causes this movement of intensity, magnetic intensity. Okay, so consequently the propagation phase constant for the forward and backward direction differs, and it has comes to be 90 degree. So how it can come to the 90 degree? We have to choose a proper length of a slab, ferrite slab, and the proper value of a DC magnetic field so that this can be 90 degree. If you want a different amount of differential propagation constant, that is this one, then you can choose different values of
length of the slab and DC magnetic field. So to summarize this, what is Faraday rotation? Because of what we can say ferrite material properties, which has unpaired electrons, and these unpaired electrons get line up with the DC magnetic field, the rotation is caused because of difference in relative permeability for holes and electrons. So because of this difference, the rotation is caused, and this rotation is known as a Faraday rotation. Now how we can use all these concepts in achieving what we want in the microwave circuits? So let's see first device, that is circulator. What we are trying to do over here, we are trying to rotate the wave in a particular fashion. So what is rotating a wave? A microwave circulator is a multi-port waveguide junction in which wave can flow only from one port to its next port. For example, nth port to n plus 1th port in only one direction. So as you can see in the diagram, where a simple 4-port circulator is shown, when if we apply a signal, microwave signal at port 1, it will take signal to only port 2. It will not go into the opposite direction. That is not possible. Okay, now only port 2 is available, or output at port 2 is available, and similarly from port 2 it will travel to port 3, from port 3 it will travel to port 4, and port 4 to port 1 again. So that is circular rotation. Okay, and this is achieved by using these ferrite devices, because these ferrite devices polarize the waves in a circular manner. Okay, although there is no restriction on number of ports, 4-port circulator is most commonly used. One of 4-port circulator is shown in figure, we will see just now. It consists of two directional couplers, to be precise, 3 dB side hole directional couplers. We have seen 2-hole directional coupler. Now in the 2-hole, we had 2 holes inside the coupler device. Now inside the coupler device, there were two holes. Now in the side hole, the holes will be at the side of a coupler device. Two directional couplers, one rectangular waveguide, and two non-reciprocal phase shifters. So let's see that circulator. This is just a schematic diagram. Actual circulator we will see later on. So there are two couplers, as you can see, coupler 1, coupler 2. Each coupler is producing 90 degree phase shift. So coupler 1 is producing 90 degree phase shift, coupler 2 is producing 90 degree phase shift. That means this coupler will come into picture. What is the job of a coupler? To couple incident wave from one waveguide to another waveguide. So this is my primary waveguide, this is secondary waveguide. So these couplers will come into picture only when wave has to be transferred from primary to secondary. Okay, remember that. If you are incidenting a wave on port 1 and taking out a wave from port 2, coupler will not come into the picture. At that time, only the other device which is mentioned over here, that is phase shifter, this is non-reciprocal phase shifter, that will come into the picture. Now as you can see, it is a non-reciprocal phase shifter. Why? Because going in the forward direction, it is producing phase shift of 180 degree, and going into the backward direction, it is producing phase shift of 90 degree. So it is not reciprocal. Forward is more, backward is less, so it is non-reciprocal. Okay, so this phase shifter produces 180 degree phase shift in forward direction and 90 degree phase shift in the backward direction. The second phase shifter produces similar kind of phase shift, 0 degrees in forward direction and 90 degree in backward direction. So if you have to consider the total phase shift produced, couplers are producing 90 degree. Let's note it down again. First phase shifter, non-reciprocal phase shifter, the total phase shift forward and backward combined is a 90 degree, or plus 90 degree I will say, because 180 minus 90 is again 90, but it is positive value, whereas second phase shift is also producing 90 degree phase shift, but it is in backward direction, so it is minus 90. Plus 90 means in forward direction, minus 90 means in backward direction. This is total phase shift produced. Okay, so now how waves are circulated. In the previous schematic we have seen port 1, if we incident a wave on a port 1, it should come out only from port 2. Okay, so output should be available only here, not anywhere else, not port 4, not port 3. Okay, now there is no chance that port 1 will give it to port 3, because of obvious reason there is no chance of propagation. Coupling is done to the forward direction. Now let's see what happens when port 1 is incident a wave. One part of this wave will directly go to the port 2. Now this part will get 180 degree phase shift. Why? Coupler 1 will not come into the picture, coupler 2 will not also come into the picture, because we are still in the same primary waveguide. Okay, because this straightforward wave transmission. So the only phase shift that is produced is by the phase shifter. Now phase shifter, we are going in the forward direction, so it will produce phase shift of 180 degree. So that's what it is mentioned here. So one component arriving at port 2 is of 180 degree phase shifted of a input wave. Now the second component, that is coming from a second component arriving at port 2, we are talking about second component will come from a couplers. Okay, so once the wave is incident on a port 1, a coupler will couple it to the secondary waveguide. Now when it couples to the secondary waveguide, there will be a 90 degree phase shift, as we have stated. So first phase shift is 90 degree. Now first phase shifter will not come into picture, second phase shifter will come into picture. So let me slightly clear this in order to avoid confusion. So 90 degree plus how much phase shift? Now first 90 degree is because of coupler. Now phase shifter will add 0 degree phase shift in the forward direction. Okay, then this wave travels to the second coupler. Now second coupler will add further 90 degree, and then wave will arrive at port 2 of at total 90 plus 0 plus 90, that is 180 degree. So both waves or both wave components arriving at port 2 are 180 degree phase shifted. Since both are 180 degree phase shifted, that means they are in phase. Phase difference is 0, and that's why they will get added and output power is obtained. So port 1 input, port 2 is output, which is non-zero and having a even larger power than the input one. Okay, so I hope this is clear. Now let's talk about why it will not come at the port 4. Port 3 is completely out of picture right now. So let's talk about why it will not be at a port 4. Let me delete this one also. So at port 2 we'll get additive phase, so total power obtained at port 2 is much larger than the incident port, but we are talking about only availing the output. Now what will happen at port 4? Now waves at port 4 will arrive from two directions. One, this direction, and second, this direction. Now let's consider the first case, that is first direction. Now how much phase shift will be added? Now when incident wave is in port 1, coupler 1 or primary guide, when it is in primary guide, coupler 1 will not come into the picture. So first phase shift is introduced by first non-reciprocal phase shifter. So it will introduce 180 degree phase shift. Sorry. Then it will enter into coupler 2 because it has to come at port 4 also. So when coupler 2 accepts this wave, which is 180 degree phase shifted, it adds further 90 degree phase shift, and the wave arrives at port 4 with total phase shift of 270 degree, which is mentioned over here. This is the first component arriving at port 4. Now second component or second direction downward. So first 90 degree phase shift introduced by the coupler 1. Okay, phase shifter 1 is out of question now. Then second phase shift added is phase shift by the second phase shifter, which is 0 degree in the forward direction, and then it will come at port 4 with total of 90 plus 0, that is total equal to 90 degree. Okay, so two components arriving at port 4. First component 270 degree phase shifted from the incident wave, and second component 90 degree phase shifted from incident wave. So what will be the resultant of all of this? One is 270, another is 90, the phase difference is 180 degree. So incident wave and output wave at port 4 should be 180 degree out of phase. So if incident wave is 1, let's say plus 1, this will produce minus 1. So plus 1 minus 1 is 0. So output at port 4 is 0. To understand more, let's take a sine wave, simple sine wave. Okay. Incident sine wave has a 90 degree angle. So sine 90 is plus 1. Now here resultant will be sine 180. So this is minus 1. So plus 1 minus 1 will be 0. So output at port 4 is 0 in that case. So 0 output means wave is not arriving at a port 4. Okay. So let's see this in terms of statements. This is all mentioned in this particular statements, 4 port circulator. You can refer that later on, but whatever I have just described, that is just all mentioned in terms of statements. Now let's talk about the port 4. The wave travels through coupler 1, the secondary waveguide, and arrives at port 4 with phase shift of 90 degree. That's what we have seen. Since the two waves reaching port 4 are out of phase by 180 degree, power transmission from port 1 to port 4 is 0. Okay, so for port 1 to port 4 is 0. That's what we have said just. In general, this differential propagation constant in the two directions of propagation in waveguide containing ferrite phase shifter should be integer multiples of either 2m plus 1 pi radian per second or 2n pi radians per second. Okay, a similar analysis may be done to show that wave incident to port 2 emerges at port 3 and so on. So this we have example taken for port 1. If it is incident with a wave, it should come only at the port 2. It will not come at port 4, not come at port 3. Now similarly, you can analyze same thing. If we incident the wave on the port 2, it should come on the port 3 only. Okay, so like this, it should not come at port 4 and not come at port 1. Okay, and if we incident a wave on port 4, it should come only at the port 1 only. Like this, we can explain it further on. So this is a practical example of a port 4 port circulator. As you can see, it uses magic T's, two magic T's and a phase shifter. Okay, now port 1 is here. So if we input a wave here, we know the functioning of magic T. Output at port 3 will be 0. Why it will be 0? Refer how magic T works. The wave will be divided into two parts. Okay, then they will arrive via this path. And enter into the second magic T. Now again, this is a sidearm. Port 4 is a sidearm. Again, output will be 0. Why it will be 0? refer functioning of a magic tee, how does it work. Now in second magic tee, waves two inputs are given from the collinear arms. This is one collinear arm, this is the other collinear arm. So two inputs are given, they will combine together and appear at port 2. Okay, to understand it mathematically, you can apply total phase shift which is added and subtracted because of all of this. But if you have to summarize this, this can be summary. Input is given at port 1, port 3 automatically 0 because of magic tee, working of magic tee. Then second magic tee comes into picture because input at 1, port 1 is divided and arrives at a second magic tee. Second magic tee accepts these two components as an input and produces output at port 2. For that, you need a perfectly matched, lossless, non-reciprocal 4-port circulator which will have an S matrix of this form, particular form. If we use the properties of S matrix, this can be further simplified. It can be further simplified to this form, so which is very simple to remember. So this is how 4-port circulator works. So that's all about a circulator. In the next video, we will see isolator and then finally gyrator. Thank you.